going on. Now, women have had the power to reconcile in the past. In the medieval church, abbesses heard the confessions of the women in their monasteries. And I might also note that some women, notably Hildegard of Bingen and others, were also preachers. One could make the argument, although I don't wish to here, that women's special gift is to be a nurturing presence, that women are better at relationships than men are. Some of what the recent Vatican document says comes close to this, and indeed some of what some feminist scholars have to say comes very close to this as well. But the point is not that women are good at relationships and men are not. It's that some people, men and women alike, are gifted with an ability to hear another's hurt and pain, to bring the healing breath of the Spirit to their lives. And as with my previous example, many women, in fact, are doing this kind of ministry, but they're sort of flying beneath the radar. Many people are willing to receive the gift of reconciliation from women, to be blessed, to be anointed. But again, this is something that needs to be done very carefully. My point is not that women should be illegally acting in the role of the ordained as a kind of lone ranger, but rather that restricting women's ministries to the home again impoverishes us as a church. And my third example has to do with the role of governance. Because again, official church governance is restricted to ordained priests and bishops. I'm very well aware that women have and are acting in important positions in the church. Women are chancellors of dioceses, they serve on marriage tribunals, and work on the committee on the sex abuse crisis. So it's not accurate to say that the church excludes women from any position of governance. But when it comes to making the really big decisions, such as who gets to be a bishop, how the lectionary is to be translated, how religious orders should revise their constitutions, even who should be a spiritual director for seminarians, again, the doors are closed. Even in parishes, while there may be a parish council elected by the parish and consisting of women and men lay members, pastors, who are by definition priests, have absolutely no obligation to listen to or even have a parish council. Fortunately, many of the fine men who are priests in this country and elsewhere take the role of parish councils very seriously and would not dream of governing their parishes all by themselves. They recognize that they need the voices of women and men in their parishes, their expertise at finance, at religious education, in music, and dare I say, in visiting the sick and dying, in preaching, and that they could not do their work without them. But the parish councils and the other women who work in helping to run the church serve only as long as they are wanted. And I know of, unfortunately, too many stories where talented leaders in a parish or diocese, often women, but not only, were summarily fired when a new pastor or bishop came into office and decided that he did not need or want any advice from the laity. And remember, all women are laity, even if you're a nun. Having such a system of governance is not good for the church or any other institution. We have seen the damage that abuses of power have had on young people who trusted the clergy they loved and whose trust was betrayed. And to run an institution from the top down without a systematic way of being in touch with the grassroots is asking for trouble no matter what kind of institution you're in. With all the problems that our country experiences in the present, we still can say nowadays that everyone over 18 has a voice, who exercises that voice at appropriate times. And monarchical systems of governance perhaps have worked well when only a minority of people had education and the knowledge needed to make important decisions. But that time is long gone in the church, and yet the church persists in organizing itself in monarchical, hierarchical structures that do not have a systematic way of ensuring that the voices of the grassroots will be heard. And I'll just tell you a little story about what it means to hear the voices of the grassroots. And this is a story that was told to me actually by Scott Appleby, who, as some of you know, is the director of the Kroc Center at the University of Notre Dame, and spoke to the bishops about the clergy sex abuse crisis a couple of years ago. And at this meeting, Scott recounted how he was listening to a conversation at which one person said to one bishop, but Bishop so-and-so, how would you feel if this were happening to your children? And the bishop responded, I don't have children. Since women have no official access to governance in the church, women's talents, and inevitably their mistakes as well, are not really welcomed by the institutional church. And even though we are all aware that there are ways that the voices of women do find their ways into the upper regions of power, it is no guarantee that they will really be listened to. So my point is to ask, what is lost to the church when women's gifts are not officially welcomed? I think a great deal. We are poorer as a church for being deprived of women's preaching, of women's pastoral work, of women's gifts and governance. Yes, some of these gifts are opened here and there, but always with an eye to making sure they don't get into trouble with the authorities. And as long as women's work is not simply seen as what it is, a great gift to the church, we will be poorer for it. Now, I want to switch things a little bit and begin to think about how we might respond to this, what I'm calling this lack of openness, and kind of move back to the question that I asked at the beginning of this. I'm getting back to the boring question. It would be great if I could wave a magic wand and change the institutional culture so as to make it more open. But I have no magic wand, and I am unlikely ever to attain any church office, and I am only one person, although I have plenty of friends who are like-minded. So what I'd like to do now is explore a little is what we as individual women and men can do in and for the church and ourselves. Because I think we can all identify the problems. Where can we go to thinking constructively? And so what I would like to do is suggest that we are not in fact powerless, and there are ways where we really can and do make a difference. And while I will emphasize the work and experiences of women, it is by no means only women who can accomplish some of the things I'm suggesting. But I'm going to begin with women's experiences and see what we can learn from them. And I want to tell a couple of stories, especially at this time of day. My first story. A little over 2 years ago, I took a trip to Africa with a group of faculty and staff from Loyola. The Jesuits have made a commitment to social justice in their universities, as you all know, and they wanted faculty and staff to have some of the same kinds of experiences that students have had on their immersion trips. So about 12 faculty and staff from Loyola went to Kenya and Tanzania for 2 weeks with the director of a nonprofit organization that has partnered with Loyola and organizations in Africa. And we met some of the extraordinary people who are living and working there. One of our trips was to the rural village of Luwak, L-W-A-K, about 20 miles from the city of Kisumu on the shores of Lake Victoria in western Kenya. Sister Pauline of the Franciscan Sisters of St. Anne, an order that was originally founded by Dutch sisters, runs a school and a novitiate. There are 800 girls who attend this school, most of them from poor families in western Kenya. HIV/AIDS has devastated the community, and while we were there, and it was kind of funny, the women stayed in the convent and the men stayed in the rectory. And the funny thing about this was that the men were free to go to the local bar and have a beer, but it was absolutely unthinkable that women would go to the bar. So men kind of chuckled at us. We'll enjoy our beer while you sit there in the convent. One of the local residents died, and we were awakened in the middle of the night by the sound of drums. Now, in addition to her work as principal of the school, Sister Pauline works to organize the local women in cooperative ventures. With the assistance of Global Alliance for Africa, the group that has partnered with Loyola, the women have begun a farming cooperative, because as some of you may know, in Africa, almost all of the food responsibilities fall on women. And they run a small store in the local community which sells soap, preserved foods, and other small items. We toured the store, the fields where they struggled to save their tomato crop after the big rains of the season. We saw the new well, which had just been completed, and which was to have a profound effect on the general health of the community. And I have to say this was the most powerful experience of the 2 weeks I had in Africa, even more so than the elephant that charged our van in the Masai Mara, the baboon who jumped into our van looking for food, or the lions of the Ngorongoro crater in Tanzania. But it's this experience of being in the walk that sticks with me.